everyone. Welcome back to the GRE How-To Series. Today, we're going to go over four key strategies to do your best on the text completion section. Stay tuned. If you watched the Getting Started with the Verbal Diagnostic Test, you saw that I struggled with the text completion, mostly because there were a lot of words that I just didn't know and I didn't have a grasp of the strategies that I really needed to employ to do well. So I did some research, I did some practice to test the research to make sure it was good advice, and I came up with four key strategies. Are you ready? First, can we celebrate the fact that we are world champions? It is great to be a Michigan Wolverine. It's great. Go on. We lost. Well, you know what? It is still great to be a Michigan Wolverine. Go blue all the way. We'll get them next time. The way the text completions are built, there are full sentences, sometimes even paragraphs, and there are 1 to 3 blanks where you're supposed to fill in the word that's supposed to go there. So it's really important to do all four strategies because you can really miss something if you don't do them all. The first key step is just to read it through without thinking too much about it, just to get the context. There's a lot of information that you can really get from there. Number two, check for clues in tone. As I mentioned before, there are a lot of clues and words around the blanks that's going to give you a sense of what's actually going on. For example, you could get a sense of if something is positive or negative, if there are words that are setting up a kind of contrast. There are words like peculiarly enough. That means that, oh, okay, this is something that's surprising. So I wanna make sure that I'm looking for some kind of word that confirms the kind of structure that the sentence is setting up. That leads us to number three. Guess what word fits using your own word. So let's do a recap. You've read for the sense of context, you've looked for the clues and seen the kinds of things that the structure is setting up for you. Next, you're gonna actually fill in the blank with your own words. It's gonna be really great to just have a word that you have a firm grasp on because you might want to brace yourself for words that you haven't heard before. So do another recap. We've read the question, we've looked for clues, we've actually come up with our own word to try to fill in the blank as we were going to say it. Now we're going to take that word and look at the answer choices, and we're going to see what matches up closest to the word that we had guessed for ourselves. Now this is going to be really helpful because even if you don't know one of the words, chances are you're going to know a few other words, and if it doesn't match with what you had anticipated the question was asking for, then you can easily check those off the list. So this is very much a process of elimination and an intentional strategy to help you solve the question. Let's look at this in practice now that we have our four strategies in place. Take a look at your Manhattan Prep 5-pound book of GRE problems and look at number four. While far from the bane that some scholars have declared them to be, versions of novels and essays do indeed excise essential elements. Students would have to supplement their reading with sources to fully understand the intent of the original. I always wondered how Cardi B can do her sound. I actually should just use her sound effect. Now that I've actually read the sentence, I have a sense of the context. So the next thing I'm going to do is think about what are the words around the blanks that give me some clues of what this is supposed to be about. While far from the bane that some scholars have declared them to be. Okay, so that means that this is something that kind of annoys scholars. So that's a helpful clue for, you know, the first blank. And the next clue that I have is that the versions excise essential elements. Oh, okay, it's incomplete. That makes me think of something that's dramatized. Like in Hamilton, if one of my favorite songs is, well, taint alert, satisfied. And Elizabeth Schuyler is talking about she's a girl in the world in which her only job is to marry rich. She says her father doesn't have any sons, so she's the one who has to social climb for one. In real life, the Schuylers were not, the three Schuyler sisters were not the only kids that they had brothers, but Lin-Manuel Miranda needed to add some kind of like saucy Broadway element to make it, you know, a Broadway show. So the whole point is that even though Lin-Manuel Miranda took some dramatic license, he still gave a nice account of the formation of America. I'm going to choose dramatized as my placeholder for this sentence. So students had to supplement their reading with some kind of sources. So since it's a supplement, I'm gonna say something like a primary source because you have to actually look at the original. Now I know that that's not the best placeholder for that because it's actually redundant. I'm just gonna keep that in mind as I check against the answer choices. Now that we have our placeholders, dramatized and primary, we're going to actually look at the answer choices. For blank number one, we've got annotated, abridged, and antedated. So for annotated, I know that that means like having a whole bunch of notes on it. And I don't think that that's something that would annoy scholars. So I'm gonna cross that off my list. Next is abridged. And for that, I know that that means shortened. And even though it doesn't completely match dramatized for me, it actually makes a lot of sense. I mean, dramatized versions are shortened versions. It leaves out certain details. And then next, antedated. I didn't really know what that meant. I mean, but ante is like before and dated sounds like dated. So thanks to the dictionary, we can know what that means. It didn't look like it matched based on how the word was structured. So I just went with abridged because it best matched my placeholder. Looking at blank number two, we've got three options as well. Complementary, complementary, and compelling. Watch out for the homonyms. It's really important to know the difference between the two. Complementary with an E is something that goes with something, whereas complementary with an I is something that's free. So I know that this sentence is not talking about something that's free, so I am gonna eliminate that. Compelling is great, but that doesn't really fit the structure of the sentence that's set up, so I'm going to cut that out as well. Complementary definitely goes well with this sentence. Putting it together, we've got, while far from the bane that some scholars have declared them to be, abridged versions of novels and essays do indeed excise essential elements. Students would have to supplement their reading with complementary sources to fully understand the intent of the original. So to recap, we've got four key strategies. First, read the sentence to understand the context. Second, look for clues around the blanks to understand the tone and the kind of words that you're looking for. Three, create a placeholder in your own words so that you know what you're looking for. And then four, match your placeholder against the answer choices to see which answer best fits the sentence. Question of the day, what are you doing to make sure that you have the stamina for both studying and actually executing against the GRE test? Leave your answers in the comments below and share with the community. I mean, what works for you? How do you stay energized throughout the entire test? That's something that we're all gonna benefit from. So thank you for your contributions to this community. And also, if you have anything that you want me to cover during this journey or anything that we can talk through, please let me know in the comments below as well.
Hail, hail to Michigan, the champions of the West. Go Blue!